Hello, and welcome to the Euro What from whatelseison.tv. I'm Mike McComb, and I'm joined today by my fellow WEIO Eurovision News and Entertainment Research Division specialists, Brian Brazell and Ben Smith. Howdy, folks.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. How are you doing?
Fantastic. I got a ridiculous tattoo.
I was about to say, Ryan, you got a tattoo. You got a Eurovision tattoo. You got something permanently inked on your body for this show.
Not just a Eurovision tattoo. It is a full upper arm tattoo inspired by Love, Love, Peace, Peace, the amazing tribute to Eurovision / making fun of Eurovision. I basically went to a local tattoo artist that a friend of mine recommended and said, so I want to do a Eurovision tattoo. And she said, a Euro what tattoo? And I said, yes, that's right. You see what I did there? And so I gave her like 5 or 10 different images from entries I have loved in the past and said, do something with this. And she put it all together and it looks great.
Right. And looking at the photo, so just things I'm catching are Twerpy Hamster Date, which is like the joke we made about Belarus like 2 or 3 years ago at this point. There's a circle piano. I mean, there's the Love, Love, Peace, Peace, and like the hat from like the Moldovan entry. So like, what else am I missing here?
Well, it's not just the hat. It's the whole unicycle ferry from Moldova 2011, was that, I think? So Lucky, Zidob.
Yeah, So Lucky.
Yep. What are you missing? Oh, so right now it's not fully colored in, so you can't see like the feathers. There's some feathers that are going to be Ireland from Dustin to Turkey. Oh, there's the star at the top from Berka Serduchka. On top of the star are some Jedward shoulder pads. There's fire on the signs because it's not Eurovision if there's not pyrotechnics. Mm-hmm. An astronaut helmet from Montenegro and a Swedish flag. So there's lots of stuff. There's all the little things. Once it's all done and all colored in, which will be a couple months from now, I'm going to put a playlist together with all the references so people can watch.
Very nice.
So I'm very excited. As I said before, I have done a lot of ridiculous things in my life, but this has to be.
I don't even know where to begin with, like, the level of dedication that this must have taken. Do you have any other tattoos, or is this your first tattoo?
No, I do have 2 other tattoos. I went big, but I didn't go big on my first time. So, I have 2 smaller ones. I definitely do not have anything else on this scale. So this was a sort of a leap of faith, but, you know, go big or go home.
And are you planning on adding to it as more pieces become part of Eurovision lore?
I have other limbs. I have a whole nother arm and 2 legs and a back and a chest, right? So I'll expand almost certainly, but not this one is like fully
here.
Formed. Yeah.
So when the Love, Love, Peace, Peace 2025 remix comes out, you'll be able to work with that.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
Exactly. Once we have a whole new bumper crop of Eurovision tropes that need inked.
Yeah.
That's right. That's exactly right. So how are you guys doing?
I'm good.
Yeah, no complaints here. Certainly like nothing on the scale of what you are getting done. Like,
yeah.
I'm still just so amazed by that. We'll have a picture of the full tattoo on our Instagram page just to show the dedication and see how many of the references can be spotted in there. Because yeah, it's the way they're woven in is amazing. So
right.
My artist did a great job.
Mm-hmm. Later in the episode, we're going to talk about how everybody did a bad job this weekend. But first, we should talk about the fact that we had semifinal allocation today.
Yes. Oh, it's like Christmas for Eurovision season for me. I don't know. I don't know how excited you get for the semifinal allocation, but I'm pretty sure I have seen everyone since 2011, and that requires waking up early.
That's a level of dedication that I am not willing to subject myself to.
Yeah, and like sometimes it's just accidental where it's just like, oh, well, I'm up anyway. Like that's what happened today. I was getting up to go to the gym. This is not a humble brag. It's just what happened. And the semifinal allocation started. I'm in Chicago. It started 6 a.m. local time here. So, yeah, just seeing what is going on in Portugal with how they are assigning who performs in which semifinal.
Right. And just to back up, like we should explain, there are 2 semifinals. These are used to determine 20 of the 26 entries that will be in the final competition. There are, I think, 43 countries participating this year. And you need to whittle that down to 26 of them. And the way they've done various ways of figuring out who gets in and who's not in. But for like at least the past 10 years that I've been watching, there have been two semifinals that determine 20 of the acts that are not the big five.
Right. The way that they try to make this process as random as possible to ensure that certain countries aren't always there with their besties. I don't know how else to describe it. But like countries like Greece and Cyprus, who are very friendly towards one another in the contest, like always giving each other 12 points, that sort of thing. They try to randomize the process to make sure that they're not always in the same semifinal. Spoiler, they're in the same semifinal this year.
And similarly, like you don't want to have all of your Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, Iceland in the same semifinal because they're going to give each other lots of points, and it's going to mean that other nations aren't necessarily going to get those points. And you want to randomize that so that every entry theoretically has the best chance of getting in. Does this work? No. No, it doesn't. But we try. Well, we don't try. The ESC tries.
Yeah, and they've also revamped the process a little bit in the last couple of years. It used to be not only would you get the allocation of which semifinal you're being placed in, but also allocating what place in the running order. So if there's 18 countries competing, they could be assigned, okay, you're in the first semifinal, and random draw, you will be performing at slot 15. And they would sometimes run into the problem of having five power ballads.
You had the bad luck of being ballad number four.
Yeah, which is like really boring for the viewer, where it's just like, oh, I can't really tell any of these songs apart. And then it's also not great from a competitive standpoint because there's nothing to really differentiate in the field. I think it was 3 years ago where they started doing, okay, we'll just assign people to either the first half or second half of each semifinal, and then the producers will determine the running order from that, just to kind of create more of a flow of show, and probably to make it easier for stagehands if they're complicated.
Yeah, that way they don't have to like wheel off the giant hamster wheel and move in like three different like blocks in the span of like 30 seconds.
And to think that they used to be able to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, I assume they would still be able to do that, but I'm sure it was a major, major headache for the stagehands.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is also important as the contest gets bigger, right? You really have about the same amount of airtime, regardless of how many countries you have, right? I mean, in the grand final, it's less of an issue because you have 26 kind of regardless, right? But, you know, as the number of countries expands, they may want to expand from 26. And so just doing anything you can to have a good flow to the show is really important. And I was looking this up because I was wondering when they started doing semifinals, and it was only 2008. So this is year 11 or whatever, the semifinals. For me, it seems like they've always done it this way because I only started watching in 2007 and I only watched the final that year. And so I've always seen semifinals. So it's just interesting to go back and go, oh, this has only been the last 10 years that they've done that. The previous 52 years of the contest, they had either no semifinal or they had like a few years they had a point base that you like the average number of points over the last X number of years or something.
Yeah, they did some way where if you had performed in a certain range in the last 10 years or so, you were in. So there were years where you just didn't get to compete because like the you had dealt yourself a bad hand in previous performances.
Right.
Which I think that the semifinal seems a little bit more fair. It means that everybody gets to perform every year if they want to.
Well, everybody asterisk.
Yeah, everybody asterisk. And we'll get to that asterisk because the fun part about having these blocks like this is that sometimes nations are friends and sometimes nations are major enemies and don't really want to talk to one another, much less be in the same semifinal. And sometimes, thanks to the random nature of this, they end up in the same semifinal and then stuff happens.
Yep.
I guess we can go into how the semifinals shook up. So in the first semifinal, there are 19 countries that are going to compete. There are 37 countries total that will be competing in the semifinals. And yeah, the way it shook out this year was really interesting in terms of how countries that have been traditionally powerhouses in the competition are mostly in the second semifinal. And so a lot of underdogs and countries that have been struggling the last few years to advance from the semifinals all got kind of pushed to the first one.
I'm just looking over the field right now, and it's like a bunch of the smaller nations that usually, I mean, there's like one or two powerhouses in there that you kind of know are going to probably make it to the final, assuming they don't completely step on their own feet, like Azerbaijan. But you have a lot of the smaller nations as well, like former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, where you see them once and then they don't make it to the final. And, you know, this year they are in a semifinal that seems a little bit more favorable to them.
We have Ireland in that first semifinal, which we were talking about this before, but I miss Jedward just so much. Like, Ireland hasn't, I feel like they haven't had a good entry since 2011, 2012 that Jedward was there in back-to-back years?
I want to say 11-12, yeah.
And they just have been nowhere since then. Just come on, Ireland. Come on.
I would hesitate to say that they weren't necessarily good entries, but they were great television.
Oh, I agree. Absolutely. I mean, that again, that was, you know, Jedward was one of the, like, entries that really hit right that perfect spot of, like, spectacle. It's not a good song, but, like, this makes for a really entertaining time.
I kind of like their songs, but that's
that's fine.
I think they also did a really good job of using the stage and like the video screens in their performances. And yeah, it seems like Ireland's been kind of going into a more subdued performance, like last year, where it was just a hot air balloon on stage. And
I had completely forgotten their entry from last year. Although now, like, all that's flooding back to me is me making very impassioned posts on the blog that, no, this would be fine if they had a singer who could sing this about an octave lower, which is not really the best of justifications for the song.
The first afternoon that I was in Kiev last year for the contest, there was one of the sort of Eurovision gathering tourist locations, and yeah, Brendan Murray, who was Ireland's representative, was there kind of wandering around, and there were like all these fangirls that were kind of swarming him. And we're just like, oh, it's him. Do you want to go up to him? No, not really. I don't have anything to say other than, oh, well, good luck on Thursday.
Yeah. Oh, bless.
Bless his heart.
Semi-1 is going to be interesting just, again, because we have a lot of the smaller nations that can otherwise be dealt kind of a crappy hand, suddenly having another chance that they might not have. And what that means for semifinal 2 is that one's going to be a nail-biter, or at least seems like it could be a nail-biter, given that it's very early in the selection season and we have no clue what's actually going to get picked.
Yeah, just kind of looking over the list right now, we only know a handful of the participants, but none of the songs that have been selected have shown up in that mix. I mean, two of the four songs that have been selected so far are Big Five entries, so they're not even in the semifinals, but then the other two are in semifinal number one.
Yeah, and like looking over semifinal two, a lot of their selection processes aren't going to be even starting until next month in February, which admittedly is only a few days away, but they're not going to be ending until late February or even this like mid-March, like with Sweden, who does sort of like a whole 6-week thing. And we've got, I mean, the sad part is that like a lot of the small nations got into semifinal one, but you have poor San Marino and Montenegro who got the bad hand of semifinal two and are just going to have to really send a great entry.
I also wonder about sort of middling countries like Hungary and Latvia, right? Who like sometimes will have a really good year, but a lot of times are just kind of on that edge.
On that cusp, yeah.
I'm feeling confident about Hungary. I've been watching their selection process this year. They've got a lot of really good songs.
Oh, like, that's great.
I don't know. I'm also biased. I just really love their process. So.
That's awesome.
I would love to see Moldova sort of keep up the momentum they had last year where they came in third, which is their best placement ever. And hopefully we'll keep along sort of that more upbeat side of things, just because when they go upbeat they tend to do well, and when they do ballads it doesn't really shake out.
I'm always a little bit concerned about smaller countries that don't have the budget for this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Whether if they do really well one year, whether the next year they're like, that was really close, we need to not do that well again, right? Like, I sort of wonder whether they're like, ooh, we came a little too close to the sun, we need to back off a little bit. So I'll be very interested to see who they actually send and how they end up.
Yeah.
I think they're being a little bit more strategic this year. Originally, their plan was to have a semifinal with 32 songs that were going to get whittled down through an audition process and then move on to a semifinal and then have like a grand final. But then after the audition process, they ended up whittling the field down to 16, and they're just like, oh, well, we'll just skip the semifinal and go right into the final, which I think is an indication that they're being more selective instead of being like, oh, everybody gets a chance to try this out. It's like, oh, no, like, we have some quality standards now that you need to meet, and yeah, then we'll throw it to the public.
Good for them.
Yeah. Okay, I mean, I think that, I mean, just from like a high level, that seems to cover sort of how the field's shaken out. Are we going to have any sort of breakdown of this on the website, Mike?
Yeah, we'll have a photo of how the allocation split up so that you can see which countries are in which half of which semifinal. And the actual running order should be coming out sometime at the end of March. And we'll have that updated as well. And if you go to the main contest page for 2018, we'll have that, the countries split out based on how they were allocated. Other updates? We've got some song selections. Yay! We finally have stuff to talk about for this song contest, everybody. So yeah, over the weekend, France had their final for their Destination Eurovision selection process. Brian, you seem to have some opinions about how things shook out. Do you want to kind of give a rundown of like what happened during the final?
Sure. Yeah, France, come on. Okay. I have to say, first of all, I'm really happy that France actually did a televised election process, because they've done internal selections recently, and I thought it was kind of hilarious that they brought out Yon Ulasand, who is, he's sort of the head of the Eurovision Song Contest. He like runs the whole process. And he came out and was like, thank you for having a public televised election process. Please keep doing this. It was basically his way of saying, France, can you please actually vet your songs before you send them? So I really appreciate that they did this process. That said,
I was waiting for the other shoe to drop on this one.
Yes, no. Like, come on, Fran. Okay, there were, I think, three songs that I either wanted to see go, or would have loved to, like, legitimately wanted to see them go, or wanted to see them go because it was weird and creepy and would have been like one of those sort of off the beat Eurovision entries. France didn't pick any of those. They picked a song called Mercy. Et là devant nos yeux, il y avait l'ennemi. Une immensité bleue, peut-être infinie, mais oui, on en connaissait le prix. Surgissant d'une vague, un navire ami a redonné sa chance à notre survie. C'est là que j'ai poussé mon premier cri. Je suis née. It is a song about refugees, and it's specifically a song about a particular refugee child that they met and sort of learned about this child's story crossing the Mediterranean. That's a big thing that's happening right now, right? A lot of refugees are trying to cross the Mediterranean to get into Europe and are dying along the way. It's a really sad situation. I am not the kind of person that wants to say we shouldn't have political songs at Eurovision. I think we should have more political songs at Eurovision.
Eurovision is not a political contest.
I know, but I love it.
Drink.
Exactly. And look, I was all on board for Jamala's song 2 years ago, 1944. It was only the thinnest veneer of not being political, right? She didn't mention Russia by name. She didn't say who the bad men with the guns were, right? But the difference between like that song that Jamala sang 2 years ago and this song by Madame Monsieur is that Jamala was singing from she was singing about her personal family and what happened to her family, right? This song is some white people in turtlenecks singing about refugees and how tragic they are. And I just cannot get past that with this song. Like, it might be a good song. I don't know. I can't even hear it in my head right now because I'm just so mad about, like, I think it's important to bring light to this topic. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of other better ways to do it. Right?
Right. And you could use actual refugee voices instead of just two very nice, like, French and Norwegian people.
Yes, exactly. So the press that it's getting about, oh, it's a feel good song. It's like, we all want to feel good about refugees without actually having to do anything to help refugees. Right. So it just feels a little bit gross in that way.
It's the retweet of songs.
It's yes, exactly, exactly. So,
but yeah, wow. I was sitting there.
That is so apt. I'm like,
it's the Twitter retweet of songs instead of going out and actually doing something.
Yes,
we wrote a song about it. Great, you're white. Do more.
Yes,
but exactly. Yeah, like I joined the middle of the France process while the two of you were like deep in it. So I joined at the midway after getting done watching Lithuania this weekend, which was an entirely different trip that I'm still not sure who got through and who didn't, because there are just 30-something entries.
So many numbers.
There are so many of them. There are so many of them. But that was the nice part about France is that it was like, these are our 8 entries. But the problem is, like, I joined you guys at, like, the 2, when you guys were, like, 2 hours in, and, like, yeah, there have been 4 entries that have played. It's like, what's going on? And as it turns out, they're doing, like, finals week at American Idol, where you do a duet with your big hero between every song, which is lovely. And there was, like, a great version of Zombie by the Cranberries. But I was also just like, why? Why is this here?
That was the part that was most baffling to me. I mean, it was kind of a carryover from the semifinals, because in the semifinals, each performer would do, like, a 45-second-ish performance of a cover of some song, and then go into the performance of their actual Eurovision entry. And it's like, okay, I think part of that is just to kind of get them used to being on stage, because it seemed like there were some contestants who had never performed on stage before. I'm not kidding. One of the contestants actually got that as their critique.
My main takeaways from France were, like, A, just do your 8 songs. B, it was very nice that they let Olivia Colman judge. She's great in everything. but yeah, like, I just, like, there were some good entries, but I would have enjoyed it more if it wasn't, like, a 4-hour-long process.
Yeah, it was drawn out. Like, I don't understand why they carried over the 2 performances for...
Well, especially because in so many of them, the person who would be representing France at Eurovision was relegated to background singer.
Right, yeah, which was nuts. And... like, in one of the performances, like, the star act was the Gypsy Kings, which is just like, wow, that's random. And, yeah, probably not the best use of their time.
I did like that France let one of the entries be Nell from the movie Nell.
And then he almost won. He came second in the public vote.
I was flabbergasted by that.
That was, yeah, that was, like, the fun part of the French voting process was just every time that I think I've cracked Eurovision, I have figured it out, I know exactly how they're going to vote. No, I am very wrong.
Nope.
Yeah, so the way that the scoring process worked this time around is they had a 10-person international jury that was assigning points to 6 of the 8 songs. So whichever song was the favorite got 12 points, whichever one was 6th favorite got 2 points, and then there were 2 songs that got 0 points from each juror. And then all of those points got tabulated, and the winner of the jury vote was Lisandro Cuxi. Sorry, Lisandro, I don't know how to pronounce your last name. And his song Eva. Elle quitte le club et sa routine. Elle quittera tout pour sa gamine. Seule au milieu des ombres sans répit, elle va danser. Eva is nothing but a heartache. And she will be. I would not have been surprised if that had won.
Oh yeah, like I was totally prepared for it to win. Was like, cool. It's like an 80s version of that one City High song. Especially because it's like a mansplainer for 3 minutes. But whatever. this has a good beat to it. I can go for it. The French public said, nah, we're good. We want these two people with guitars.
Well, and
yeah,
yeah, and I would have been okay if Lisandro had gone. He was not my favorite singer. My favorite was called OK Ocal by Emmy Liana. Mais c'est moi qui décide, c'est moi qui la décide. Vers un moitié pilin, vers un moitié fil, la vie, je l'aime ou la pime. Sourire ne me va rien, souffrir ne me mène à rien. Quand je fais le vide, quand je fais le plein, je vais pas mal, je vais bien. I'm actually real mad because it's available in the iTunes store in France and in Iceland, but not in the United States. So iTunes need to get on that so I can go buy it. I think Emmy Liana definitely had the best visual presentation. I think Lisandro probably had the best musical presentation. Mercy had neither of those. So I'm just confused by what the French public were thinking.
I mean, on the other hand, like, if I had to pick which entry looked the most French to me, it actually probably would have been Emiliana, just because it felt very artsy. But like, as like a backup to that, I would have picked, is it Madame Monsieur or is it Monsieur Madame?
Madame Monsieur.
Okay. But yeah, it's like, okay, cool. They're just like a couple berets away from being just like the nice stereotype.
But see, Ben, you're only saying that because you missed the creepy wooden puppet guy.
I did come into that late, and I just heard that there was like a warhorse puppet. I was like, what?
It was a very small, the performer's name was Igit, and it was called Lisboa, Jerusalem. So Lisbon, Jerusalem. And they had three, so at Eurovision, you can have six people on stage, right? That's not true of the national selection processes. You can do whatever you want. You have to translate it for the Eurovision stage, right? But in his performance at the French national final, it was him singing. And there were three people all animating this very small, like knee-high wooden puppet with these very small hands. Like the creepy part were the small hands that would occasionally rub Igit's face, like touch it. Like it was weird. I have a friend.
Yeah, it was like Christian Wiig in the Lawrence Welk sketches.
I have a friend who is like super creeped out by raccoons because of their tiny hands, and I like showed her this video, and she was like freaking out at the like tiny hands, right?
Darn it, France! Come on.
Yeah, it was not good. It was not good.
Why? That's somehow even better than like three people doing a war horse puppet, because at least then you could have them be the backup singers.
Exactly.
Maybe now would be a good time to mention that one of the other rules at Eurovision is you're not allowed to have animals on stage, so maybe creepy raccoon hands would not have been so France. So
France did a bad job.
Real bad. Bad job, France. Bad job.
Okay, so when last we spoke, we had mentioned that the Czech Republic was doing something very interesting where it seemed like all of the songs were online, and there wasn't like a broadcast final. They were just on the internet with some lyric videos, and there was voting by the app. That's done now.
Yay!
Is Mikolas Josef.
Boo!
Boo? Why boo?
No, like, I actually like the song here. Like, there's like a nice, like, kind of horn riff thing going on that reminded me of Moldova's entry from last year. That I really liked, and like in general, I kind of like the song. I'd need to not see his face while he performs it.
Well, first of all, can we listen to a clip?
Yes.
Lie to me, oh baby, come a little closer. Lie to me. Lie to me, oh baby, lean upon my shoulder. Lie to me. Get down on my body, love me like it was always meant to be. Now you love somebody new, I always knew. So come and give it to me.
Okay, so that clip, I really like the song, and I completely second you, Ben. I can't actually, he is so smarmy that I was watching the video for this, and I was like, I hate this song. And then I was like, wait, no, I think I just hate him. And I closed my eyes and I was like, oh, this song is so much better. I cannot, like, so much of Eurovision is the visual presentation, I can't watch him.
I don't think I've actually seen him perform. Like, I've only, like, the only visual aspect I've seen has been the lyric video, which is just, like, lots of photos and text on the screen. So that doesn't really tell me anything. But yeah, like, the song, the challenge with this song is it's kind of raunchy. And yeah, there's a lot of F-bombs and such. So it'll be interesting to hear how this gets edited to comply with, like, Eurovision rules, and whether or not that's going to change the song in a cartoonish way. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't want this to go full Kids Bop. Although if it did, that would be kind of hilarious. Now I do kind of want to hear that version.
If it was in like Czech or something instead of English, they could just do what Despacito did at the Grammys last night and like just have the song be the song, and then like the performance can illustrate how raunchy it is. That was like one of the legit good performances at the Grammys last night was Despacito. And it was filthy.
One of the things about this song and its raunchiness that I don't understand is I am not used to a camel being used as a stand-in for a penis. Usually, like, a camel toe, right, is, like, tights that are too tight on a woman's uvula.
Mm-hmm.
No, sorry.
No. Not the American uvula. Audience knows what camel toe is. American audience knows what camel toe is. They don't
uvula
know what your vision
is. Uvula is the thing in the back of your throat, right? We just lost Mike for tonight. Lost Mike?
Mike is dead. Mike died. Mike died of dysentery. Rest his soul.
Okay, let me start that over again. Yeah. Okay.
Well,
so
is it bad that like I can immediately see how this translates? I'm like, oh yeah, humps.
I just don't understand. Like camel, I am not used to hearing camel as a stand-in for penis. He talks about getting his camel ready to go or something, and I'm like, that is usually a stand-in for a vulva. That is not, you know, camel toe. That is not. So I am very confused by sort of, I guess, national cultural raunchiness, which is one of the reasons I think I like Eurovision, because I learn things about how other countries like talk about stuff, particularly raunchy.
I mean, on
things.
The other hand, maybe he's just going on a nomadic trek for your love.
Maybe. I mean, look, this is Eurovision. I really shouldn't be putting this much thought into it. I really
But yeah. Anyways, that is the Czech Republic's entry. It's filthy, and hopefully, you know, they'll probably, I mean, if nothing else, they can take the Swedish approach from last year and just change it to Frick.
Yeah.
Actually, no, not even Frick, Freak.
Yeah.
And we'll just know in our hearts and in our Spotify's that the version with the F word is way better.
I'm really curious to see what the final product of this one is, because, like, this is a really good pop song, and I Czech Republic made a good choice. See, France.
Why can't you be more like your brother, the Czech Republic? Actually, I have no clue if they would be brothers or whatever. We're in a whole different territory here. But Czech Republic did a good job this week. Okay, so let's talk about Spain. And can I just try to make a prediction here? Because, they literally, like, just named what their entry is, right?
Like, 30 minutes ago, yeah.
Okay. Which it's like two
yeah,
in the morning
we're recording
there.
This on Monday night, and
we were
yeah,
recording this
Spain.
Monday night. Spain was up until 2 a.m.
to watch some mostly some not great songs and a couple of okay ones.
Okay,
Ryan, it sounds like you actually watched the process. So do you want to give a rundown of what happened?
Yeah, sure. So it's interesting. I don't know who described this as Big Brother plus Spanish Idol, but that's super accurate. They like. Basically, like, live together, and they show you a lot of the, well, they don't necessarily live together, but they show you a lot of the sort of behind-the-scenes pieces over the course of several weeks to sort of get to this final stage. They, like, record people in rehearsals and stuff, so you can see, like, the, you know, behind-the-scenes of making the songs. And in this final round, what they did was they had 8 entries. There was like only 5 people, and they were like singing in different combinations. So each person had their own individual song, and then they also were singing a duet with someone else. So everybody competed a couple different times, but this was completely a televote. So people like called or texted in their vote. And I appreciate what France could learn from Spain. Although I wouldn't say that Spain's results turned out really any better. I don't really like the song all that well, but, they had sort of a 2-part final where they voted on all 8, and they took the top 3, and those people performed again. And then everybody voted again just on those top 3, which I think is better, because then you actually can see, like, okay, what are the favorites? And then people can decide between those, as opposed to you having to decide between 8, and then the votes get split in weird ways, and then a song like Mercy ends up at the top. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm bitter.
Well, it feels slightly more fair to, okay, we've got it down from, we start with a larger field and get it down to 2 or 3 entries, and then do another round of voting. It's a way of sort of doing ranked choice voting without actually doing ranked choice voting.
That's exactly right. So the song that won is a song by Amaya and Alfred. It's called Tu Canción, and it's a ballad duet. Let's take a listen.
Ya no puedo inventarlo. Siento que va a ir.
had you not told me it was a piano duet, I would have guessed it was going to be a piano duet just from the title, Tu Canción, your song.
Exactly. Yeah, you know, it was not, it was my least favorite of the top three. I have to say, I think the top three that came out of the last eight, I think those were the right decisions. I think those were probably the best three songs of the last eight. There were more, and I didn't see whether the top eight were really the top eight. But yeah, I think that those were the three best. Tu Canción was not my favorite. I really liked a song called Lo Malo, but it was a reggaeton song, and I'm pretty sure that would not have gone over well at Eurovision. We've seen what happens whenever, you know, you try to introduce something a little different that's not sort of your standard Euro pop or punk or rock.
Yeah, but that would be so outside the norm for Spain that I think they would get some sort of credit for it. Or if anything, it's just like, well, nothing else we do works. Let's just throw this at the wall.
We sent another slow ballad and it didn't work.
Yeah,
well, we should send another slow ballad.
Especially one that sounds so much like last year's winner from Portugal. It's like,
that was my first thought, too, was like, this sounds like the Portuguese entry, which seems like a bad idea to start with because you don't want to vote for the same thing twice in a row. Maybe you do. I don't know. I don't know your life.
Don't judge.
No,
and
look, last year's was lovely, but like I want a different thing to win.
Yeah, right. One of the things I really liked about Lo Malo was that it was a duet between two women, as opposed to sort of your standard, like, I mean, when was the last time we saw a duet with two women? I mean, it would have been the Sisters from Russia, right?
Yeah.
Wow, has it been that long?
Well, yeah, there was the Sisters from Russia. I was thinking all the way back to, like, Israel back in, like, 08, 09.
Oh, sure, yeah.
There was a duet between two women.
Well, and, wow. Yeah, and duets, I don't like duets at Eurovision because unless the two people have really good chemistry, and they typically don't, right?
Yeah, they're tricky. Yeah, I was about to say, I remember, like, Romania has sent the same duo a few times, and, like, both of their duets just felt sort of, like, very thin scaffolding for some sort of visual component.
Such as a circular keyboard that is now part of a tattoo.
Yeah, such as a circular keyboard that's part of Ryan's tattoo.
That's correct.
Or like, the one time where it's just, like, we have pianos that shoot off fireworks, which, in retrospect, was very cool. But, like, the song was called Playing with Fire, and it was basically a paint-by-numbers of, okay, how can we cram a bunch of pyro into this?
Hey, they got third place, so don't knock the pyrotechnics.
I'm not, like, it was, at the time, it was a very good entry, but also, it's not a great duet.
Yeah.
Yeah, duets are just so tricky because it's just, like, if they're, like, true duets where there's, like, the going back and forth and, like, sort of a call and response type thing, that's one thing, but if you have something like Verona from last year where it's two people with zero chemistry standing very far apart from each other on
standing
stage.
Standing at opposite ends of the stage and yelling at each other.
Yeah. And people were surprised that it didn't advance.
There's so much like this. You can walk towards each other.
Yeah, there have been some good duets. Like, we had a duet from Azerbaijan win a few years ago. We had the duet from the Netherlands with Waylon Jennings or is that his name?
No, just Waylon.
Just Waylon. Yeah. Waylon Jennings is this year's
Dutch competitor.
Yes.
And another person. But yeah, so they can go very well, but I think there's usually, like, when they go well, there is much more of a mesh of voices.
Yes. Oh, and what was the other really good, was that the really good?
That was Estonia a few years ago, where that one was, like, back and forth, but again, there was a sense of parody.
Yeah, exactly. And this is not, and the other thing about this particular, these particular two people is they're also really young. And I think this is going to go more the, that Chain of Lights, was that?
That was
San Marino.
And a brief Valentina Minetta-esque period.
Yeah, exactly. I think it's going to go more. And that's actually when I heard them, I thought, oh, this kind of sounds like last year's winners, except it sounds like the two, like, young teenagers from Chain of Light singing last year's winner, which is not a good combination. I don't think they're going to do well. I don't think it's a good pick.
It is not a Reese's Peanut Butter Cup situation.
Correct.
Speaking of not a Reese's Peanut Butter Cup situation,
you got your Russia. Ukraine in my Russia. You got your Russia in my Ukraine. Everybody's mad.
Yeah, so Russia,
let's,
a little bit of a history lesson yeah,
let's,
last
let's,
year.
Let's jet back year. To the faraway year of 2017. The place, Kiev. The news, Russia has picked a performer who picked on the Crimean Peninsula, which is a big no-no to the Ukrainian public, who will not let her perform. the EBU, Quippy steps in and is like, okay, we've got it figured out. Russia, you can perform remotely, and that way you can still be part of the show. Russia immediately is like, nope. Ukraine's like, nope, we're not even broadcasting that. That quickly gets set aside. Russia is allowed to pull out, and Russia vows to send Yulia Samoyeva again.
Can I add one thing to your history lesson?
Please do.
Yulia Samoylova, I don't know how to say her last name, is in a wheelchair. She is disabled. And I am pretty sure that Russia picked her in particular, knowing that Ukraine would throw a fit, so that they could say, and they actually did say, basically, when Ukraine said, well, you can compete, or when the EBU said, what about competing remotely? Russia said, are you really going to treat this disabled woman like a second-class citizen? That was
when they picked her last year, I was like, this is a very calculated move from an image perspective, and I do not like it.
Shenanigans.
Yeah, shenanigans everywhere. Fast forward to 2018. Russia has kept their word, which is great. They are sending Yulia Samoyeva again. We're going to figure out what song she's singing in a few weeks, and hopefully it's better than the one they sent her in 2017. Like, that's part of the reason I did not like the optics of that situation, was because I thought the song was crappy. Anyways, with today's semifinal allocation, Russia and Ukraine are in the same semifinal again, which is going to be real fun.
Yeah, and apparently there may also be issues with broadcasting people. So the issue at hand is performers who have performed in Crimea. If they didn't enter Crimea by way of Ukraine, they end up on a blacklist where they are no longer allowed in Ukraine. And that's a situation here. And apparently the blacklist may also extend to just broadcasting people who are on the blacklist. Like, it doesn't even matter if they're not physically in the country. Like, if you are on this blacklist, you cannot be on Ukrainian airwaves. So that could cause problems down the road, just because one of the provisions at Eurovision is all performances, regardless of political situations, must be televised.
Well, yeah, and like, we had a situation a few years ago where Armenia declined to participate in when Azerbaijan hosted, for I think similar reasons, is that they were unwilling to broadcast one of the performers due to some geopolitical issues, and the EBU sort of gave them a chance to say, okay, we're not going to participate this year. And I think part of it was just also they were fearing for, like, the safety of their performer in the country.
Right.
Yeah, there were security issues, but, I mean, Armenia went through, like, the processes and be like, okay, we're going to go, on second thought, maybe this isn't the best idea.
We're good.
Just decide to take a break.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and so part of me wonders, on the one hand, yes, good for Russia, because when they said, oh, well, we'll send Yulia again next year, I was like, they're not going to do that. But now I wonder, if there is a problem with broadcasting her image, is this Russia's way of saying, well, we're going to, you know, make ourselves look good by actually staying true to our word, but also, is this a way to get Ukraine to step out of, to basically be disqualified or to leave the contest this year? Because if they don't broadcast her performance, they will get disqualified next year, or they can choose to step out this year and not broadcast it and suffer no penalty next year, but basically not compete this year. So is this Russia's backhanded way of getting back at Ukraine for last year?
Interesting. But yeah, it right now it's just one big game of chicken.
Yep.
And we're going to see who falls into the pool.
I don't know if that's how the metaphor goes.
Yeah. Now that I sit here thinking about it, have I ever played the game chicken? No.
That's not how it works, man.
That's not how many things work. At the very least, that's not how Russia and Ukraine work.
That's right.
So that's going to be a whole big thing in a few weeks. We can talk about it then, when it's a whole big thing.
Yep.
Another whole big thing that we could try and jump on now is, Macedonia, but it's the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. Mike, why is it the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia?
Because I got yelled at on Twitter several years ago. No, so
I think it was me that yelled at you. I think it was meant as a joke.
Oh, no.
Where you said something, and I was like, no, it's the glorious former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia.
Yeah, so Eurovision is very particular about the names of countries. I believe the distinction is it's the name that a country goes by at United Nations, which is why it's Czech Republic instead of Czechia at this point. Oh. Although I don't know if that changeover is ever going to happen.
See, that's more, I feel like the whole Czechia thing is sort of a fetch situation.
Yeah,
Trying to make it happen.
Even people in the
where the Czech Republic's come up with a cool new nickname for themselves, and it's like, no, my friends call me Czechia. Like, no, we don't.
Yeah. I saw a story somewhere about how people in Czech Republic are just like, whatever. So, not sure it's going to stick. Anyway, yeah, the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia formed after Yugoslavia was no longer a republic. So that's how the FYR part of the name works. And the difficulty is the Macedonia region includes both the country that is sometimes referred to as Macedonia, but then there's also a portion of Greece that is technically Macedonia if you go back to like ancient Macedonia.
It's sort of geographic Macedonia, if you will.
Yeah. So yeah, if you refer to something as Macedonian, it could mean either the former Yugoslav Republic or it could mean the section of Greece. I think there may even be like a third section, but I don't have a map in front of me, and this is already getting way too in the weeds. But yeah, if you just refer to it as Macedonia, people on Twitter may get cranky and yell at you. And since then, I have learned it, lived it, and loved it. FYRM. So.
Well, and also, I just like the fact that like it gives me a chance to just say former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia at every possible opportunity. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, particularly on Jeopardy. Like, I have yelled at contestants like through my TV, just being like, nope, it's FYR.
Guys, it's the former Yugoslav Republic. Have some respect. Anyways, Macedonian Radio and Television has launched a global search for its next Eurovision Song Contest entry. So goes the press release. If you're an interested songwriter or a producer, you have until the 8th of February to submit an entry. So you've got like a week, weekish, that kind of area. Oh, no, 2 weeks, now that I think about it. You have time to like pull your thoughts together, put pen to paper, and put together like a demo or like a final version or just like a sketch of the song and mail it into them. Songs can be submitted either by email or by post. And they're, you know, you need to make sure that it's within the EBU eligibility rules, which means that you can't have written the song or performed it before September. But if that's all cool, if that's just gravy there, you can, the broadcaster will find a suitable act to perform it. So, which is great news for me as someone who has no former Yugoslavic Republic of Macedonian blood. It means that if I get my stuff in order and write something down that's 3 minutes and send it in and they like it, they can just find somebody else to sing it.
Am I remembering correctly that it was the FYR Macedonia that sent Blackstreet a couple years ago as backup singer for their kind of terrible lead singer? Am I remembering this correctly?
Yes. That was Autumn Leaves.
Yes.
I don't recall that singer's
Daniel
name
something.
At the moment. But
he was Macedonian.
Yeah. And like, I really like that song. Blackstreet didn't really add much to it, partly because I don't think that they knew that they were getting that gig until maybe 30 seconds before someone hit send on the press release.
They just happened to be in the area and somebody shooed them into this arena. And next thing they knew, there was music.
Yeah, it was weird. It was real weird, is all I'm saying. So maybe Blackstreet could just go back and actually perform this time.
Ooh.
Anyways, if you would like to be the Macedonian entry for Eurovision, it sounds like they are welcoming songs at the moment. So get on that.
Also, someone please tell Blackstreet, is my point. If you have a way to get in touch with Blackstreet, please tell them.
Or include in your submission, please send to Blackstreet. Yeah. We know you know their number.
Exactly.
As long as they haven't like blocked it.
Exactly.
But yeah, we'll have a link to that press release in the show notes for this week's episode. And if you are actually going to submit a song, we'd love to talk to you about it and see what you come up with. Yeah, we're genuinely interested in seeing this happen. We missed the boat on being part of San Marino's selection process. I really think that we can make Eurovision happen here. So
okay, so I think that does it for current status of entries, but it is a blazing weekend ahead in terms of stuff happening. Who all do we have on the docket?
Oh, goodness. We have Malta and Switzerland. They will be making their selections this weekend. Malta has their national final on Saturday, and Switzerland has their final on Sunday. And then we have a bunch of selection processes that are getting underway. Latvia will be starting their Supernova process Saturday, and Sweden will be starting their Melody Festivalen also on Saturday.
Yes.
And yes. Yeah, that one's the gold standard.
That one's the good selection process. Mm-hmm. That one's the one where it's worth watching all 6 weeks. Mm-hmm.
And then next week, Denmark will be releasing their songs in preparation for their national final, which will be the following weekend. And United Kingdom, are they next week? I don't have the calendar.
I want to say they are like the first full week of February. So not this weekend, but probably next weekend. And so the website Pop Justice, which we will link to in the notes, has a great rundown of the various entries floating around for this, where they have ranked them from worst to least worst. And it's very, very accurate. I kind of just want to, like, as we get closer to that or, like, right before that, I really just want to drop a mini-episode about why are these so bad?
United Kingdom chooses on February 7th. So, yeah, we'll definitely have that mini-episode in next week for UK and if they'll figure their stuff out.
Yelling at the UK about what a bad job they're doing.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they seem to be trying or trying
English
to try.
English is their first language.
I know.
Okay, but we have talked several times about how lyrics are really not the point in Eurovision, right? Like, I feel like you almost have to have some lyrics that are a little bit wonky in order to really fully succeed at Eurovision, right? Like, if it's too perfect, that doesn't work.
But I don't want it to be too perfect. Like, I mean, I agree with you. Like, I enjoy, like misused idioms or, like, just weird turns of phrase that aren't real turns of phrase.
Yeah, just experiencing a song where it's very clear that English is not their first language.
Right. And, like, if it's grading on a curve or whatever. But, like, the UK lyrics are just so insipid. I don't know. I won't get into too much detail about it now since we'll be talking about it next week. But yeah, like, try harder, UK.
Everyone did a bad job this week except for the Czech Republic. And
mm-hmm. And they didn't do a great job.
They didn't do a great job.
They did an okay
but, like,
job.
But if
oh, disagree.
But compared to France and Spain, which should think about what they've done.
Yes. Go to your room, France and Spain.
And they better think about what they've done.
Examine your choices.
I have to say, I'm kind of excited for Latvia's process to start. Aminata has a song in the contest that she has written, and it's going to be hosted by Justs, who was the representative from Latvia 2 years ago. So I'll be excited about that.
Yeah, that should be fun.
It's coming up.
A bunch of their songs are available on Spotify, and it's a really strong field this year. Latvia's really turned it around since they started using this Supernova format. This is the fourth year that they've done it. And, like, I used to be, like, totally anti-Latvia, and now I'm completely in their camp. So,
what was the song that they sang a few years ago that had, like, a keytar in it?
It
was like an iPad keytar.
Here we go.
Yeah,
yes. Stage dive.
Like yes.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and I just remember that song just felt like you were sitting in an Abstinence pep rally.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was my favorite. It was a keytar, but like with an iPad instead of the keys. Yeah, that was amazing. I still appreciate that performance. Not the song, the performance.
No, the song was terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I'm going to throw that one into the show notes just to see like where Latvia has risen from. That really was a low point.
But didn't they also send cake to bake, and that was also a pretty low note? Or am I misremembering?
I like that song. that's kind of where it started to turn around. Yeah. For me. It's like, you know, it's not a great song, but
it's better than when
I
they
see
sent,
what they're doing with
better
it.
Better than when they sent that iPad keytar.
Yeah, exactly. Like you can't get any worse than keytar.
Yeah, the cake to bake was 2014, so that was the year before they started using Supernova. So yes,
the only thing worse than the keytar is a keytar that's made with an iPad.
That's going to do it for this episode of the Euro What. Thanks for listening. The Euro What podcast is a production of whatelseison.tv. Our Eurovision News and Research Division specialists are Ryan Grizzell, Mike McComb, and Ben Smith. Follow our coverage of the 2018 Eurovision Song Contest at our website, eurovision.whatelseison.tv. You can also catch us on social media at EuroWhat on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. If you'd like to contact us by email, we can be reached at esc@whatelseison.tv. We'd love to hear your questions and comments. You can subscribe to the EuroWhat on iTunes and Google Play. While you add the subscription, leave us a review and let us know how we're doing. We'll be back with more Eurovision updates next week.